And unto the angel of the church in Sardis write, these things saith he that hath the seven spirits of God and the seven stars. I know thy works, that thou hast a name, that thou livest and art dead. Be watchful and strengthen the things which remain, that are ready to die, for I have not found thy works perfect before God. Remember therefore how thou hast received and heard, and hold fast and repent. If therefore thou shalt not watch, I will come on thee as a thief, and thou shalt not know what hour I will come upon thee. Thou hast a few names, even in Sardis, which have not defiled their garments, and they shall walk with me in white, for they are worthy. He that overcometh, the same shall be clothed in white raiment, and I will not blot out his name from the book of life, but I will confess his name before my Father and before his angels. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. And to the angel of the church in Philadelphia write, these things saith he that is holy, he that is true, he that hath the key of David, he that that openeth and no man shutteth and no man openeth. I know thy works. Behold, I have set before thee an open door, and no man can shut it. For thou hast a little strength, and hast kept my word, and hast not denied my name. Behold, I will make them of the synagogue of Satan, which say they are Jews and are not, but do lie. Behold, I will make them to come and worship before thy feet, and to know that I have loved thee. Because thou hast kept the word of my patience, I also will keep thee from the hour of temptation, which shall come upon all the world to try them that dwell upon the earth. Behold, I come quickly. Hold that fast which thou hast, that no man take thy crown. Him that overcometh will I make a pillar in the temple of my God, and he shall go no more out. I will write upon him the name of my God, and the name of the city of my God, which is New Jerusalem, which cometh down out of heaven from my God. And I will write upon him my new name. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. And unto the angel of the church of the Laodiceans write, these things saith the Amen, the faithful and true witness, the beginning of the creation of God. I know thy works, that thou art neither hot nor cold. I would that thou wert cold or hot. So then, because thou art lukewarm, and neither cold nor hot, I will spew thee out of my mouth. Because thou sayest, I am rich and increased with goods, and have need of nothing, and knowest not that thou art wretched and miserable and poor and blind and naked, I counsel thee to buy of me gold tried in the fire, that thou mayest be rich, and white raiment, that thou mayest be clothed, and that the shame of thy nakedness do not appear, and anoint thine eyes with eye salve, that thou mayest see. As many as I love, I rebuke and chasten. Be zealous therefore and repent. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hear my voice and open the door, I will come into him and will sup with him and he with me. To him that overcometh will I grant to sit with me in my throne, even as I also overcame and am set down with my Father in his throne. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. We're talking about Sardis here from Revelation chapter 3. We've got four churches behind us in our study, and now we're on to the next. This is Sardis. To the angel in the church of Sardis write, these things saith he that hath the seven spirits of God and the seven stars. I know thy works, and that thou hast a name that thou livest and art dead. Jesus here is writing from the standpoint of being him that has not only the seven stars, which we found out are the angels of the seven churches, but he also has the empowerment that is behind them, being the seven spirits of God. If you want to write the reference down, that's in Isaiah chapter 11 and verse 2. Keep your finger, as always, in Revelation chapter 3 or a bookmark or whatever. But in Isaiah chapter 11 and verse 2, you're going to find, I think, what is the best indication of what the seven spirits of God are. In Isaiah chapter 11, and verse 2, it says, or in verse 1, it says, and there shall come forth a rod out of the stem of Jesse, and a branch shall grow out of his roots. This is referring to Jesus Christ being the branch. You'll find him mentioned many times in Zechariah as well. In the book of Isaiah, he's being foretold to come out of the stem of Jesse, which had already happened at this point of time, but was going to reverberate through history until we got to Christ's actual birth. But here prophesied, and the Spirit of the Lord, verse 2, the Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him. The Spirit of wisdom, that's 2, and understanding, that's 3, the Spirit of counsel, that's 4, and might, 5, and the Spirit of the knowledge and of the fear of the Lord. Here are the 7 spirits of God, I believe, and how they would empower the believer is plain to see. Wisdom, understanding, counsel, knowledge, the Spirit of the Lord upon somebody, giving them that anointing, and the fear of God being the beginning of all of these things as they come into their fullness. So the 7 spirits of God here, I believe, mentioned of the Lord: wisdom, understanding, counsel, might, knowledge, and the fear of the Lord. These spirits then would be great to be upon any Christian. And here God announces, hey, I have them. So what do we need? We need God. Faith fastened is what I'm talking about today. Faith fastened. We need to fasten our faith upon the God that has the preachers in his hand, not only, but he also has the spirits of God that give us the power to do his work upon him and ready to impart. Resting upon him is the spirits, and he is able to impart them unto the 7 angels. The 7 angels then distributed them unto the preachers, and it's not just limited to these 7. Of course, even now today, God is doing the same things. Here he announces to this church, which we can use it as an example, he says, I know thy works, as he says to every church. As we need to understand, he's saying to every Christian, every church that even exists, I know thy works. That means God knows every evil work that we do. And that's depressing and that's disappointing. But you know, God also sees the good works that we do. And that's what we always need to focus on. Is say, hey, it's easy to get beat down and defeated and all the sins that are besetting me. Hey, confess those things. Move on. Build a bridge and get over it. Okay? This is what we need to do. We need to confess our sins. And God is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all those trespasses. But we need to understand also that God knows our good works. The simple way that we help somebody, we love our family, the things that we do within the comfort of our own homes, the little things that we do when we think they're tiny and insignificant in the grand scheme of things, God sees those works. He says, and he sees that moment where you stop and you pray for a loved one. He sees when you pick somebody up and give them a ride. He sees when you go out of your way to just give a little tiny opportunity of love and extend it to somebody. God sees those works. Take courage, Christian. He knows your works. But as it often does, God takes a message like this of knowing your works, and he always tries to spin it to bring in a negative connotation. He's not always beating on people. He's usually positive, negative, and positive, because God wants to build us up to do more of the right things, but it's good when we hear when we're doing things wrong. Wouldn't you agree? I love when the Bible corrects me, because the Bible teaches of itself that when you're receiving rebuke, when you're being chastened, it's a sign to you that you're within the love of God. Whom I love, I rebuke and chasten. We just read that a little bit earlier from the church in the Laodiceans. As many as I love, I rebuke and chasten. Be zealous, therefore, and repent. So when we're chastened of God, that should encourage a zeal in our heart to get that right and to move on and to do right things. He also here knows their works. On top of that, he knows that this group has a name, that thou livest and art dead. So this group has a living name, but they're dead. This preacher has a living name, but he's dead. And this is often confusing to some people, because how can something exist that is dead? How can something be hearing that is dead? How can something be receiving reproof that is dead? Well, take a verse like this and use it as a proof text to what we're often challenged with in James chapter 2 and verse 17. So Revelation chapter 3, you're already there, but go to James chapter 2. In James chapter 2, this is the faith without works is dead challenge that people that want you to repent of all your sins before you can be saved will take from. They say that unless you are doing the works, you are not actually saved, because you'll have a dead faith. Here in the Bible, we find somebody that has a living name, but they're dead, and that's a conflict to our minds somehow, until we actually look at what the Scripture says about being dead. In James chapter 2 and verse 17, the Bible says, even so, faith, if it hath not works, is dead, being alone, okay? Well, there it is. If you're not just saved by faith, you're also saved by works, right? That's what they'll all say. But the best thing I like to do with people when they bring false doctrine to me is to go straight to the Bible that they're trying to preach to me. Amen. And I just reach into the context, usually the verse before it and the verse behind it is enough. But James chapter 2 is one that we should all arm ourselves with the ability to expound. Go back to verse 14. It says, what doth it profit? And this is the focus of the context in James chapter 2. What doth it profit, my who? Brethren, okay? He's talking to believers. And that usually just wipes everything right away. Because if he's going to say faith without works is dead, being alone, and then the person that is a false teacher is going to tell you, well, then they're not really saved because they don't have the works. Well, this is talking to brethren here. So we know that the context is a believer that is going to learn a spiritual truth about living in the believing position, okay? Though a man say, so what doth it profit, my brethren? Though a man say he hath faith, and have not works, can faith save him, okay? So the man here is proclaiming. He is saying something. And the next point of the context that I want to grab hold of is verse 15. It says, if a brother or sister be naked or destitute of thy daily food, in verse 16, and one of you say again unto them, depart in peace and be warmed and filled, notwithstanding ye give them not those things which are needful to the body, what doth it profit? And so this is the focus of what we're talking about. This is a believer who is saying he has faith. I am saying I am a believer, but there is no works associated with, okay? The brother or the sister comes unto them naked and destitute of the food that they need, and the brother does not profit at all because all he does is say, oh, God bless you. Be warmed and filled, and just sends them on their merry way instead of actually doing the works and giving them the things needful for them. Okay? It is not profiting then the brother or the sister that the man is just saying, I have faith. That the man is just saying, go and believe. You know, I believe that you'll be warmed and filled. I'm praying for you. It doesn't profit the brother or sister. And that's what's being discussed here. Just your faith actually does no good to anybody else around you. It does good for you because your faith, by grace are you saved, through faith, not all of yourselves, is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. Your faith is sufficient to save you. That's all you need to give to God is your belief and your trust in Him. But my faith, sitting at home twiddling my thumbs, is doing nothing for the brothers and sisters around me. When they come to me and they say, hey, you're a believer, can you help me with such and such? If I say, yeah, go and be warmed and filled, I'm praying for you. I offer you faith. I give faith unto God that He would supply your need. Verse 17, even so faith, if it hath not works, is dead. And here's the definition of dead, being alone. Okay, being alone. Death is a separation. Death is when the body falls, the spirit goes one place, and the soul goes to another. It's that separation. So if your faith has not the works to go with it, it's dead. It's on its own. It's you sitting at home twiddling your thumbs, not getting any work done that is going to actually help your brother. And all that's happening here is something is being said, but nothing is being done. And so in the context of all this, we see that yes, a dead faith can save, but dead faith will not help anybody else around you. It is dead. It is alone. So, we see then in verse 24, it says, ye see, and this is a conclusion of the matter, essentially. Ye see, and this was talking about Abraham, who acted out his faith by offering his son Isaac upon the altar years after he was saved, before men, so that they could see the testimony of a man and proclaim that he was a friend of God. He says this, ye see then how that by works a man is justified and not by faith alone. What is he talking about? The fact that a believer could have just believed and lived on an island and done nothing with his salvation. But until Abraham stepped out and by faith did a really big work, offering his son upon the altar, lifting the blade up and getting ready to strike it into his son before the moment that the angel said, do it not. And then he stopped. Until that had happened, nobody would have testified that Abraham was a believer. Nobody would have testified that he was a friend of God until that moment came to pass. He was justified before men by showing his faith out in works. And this is what it means. The Bible says then, and it continues on, likewise also, was not Rahab the harlot justified by works when she had received the messengers and had sent them out another way? What had happened was Rahab was a believer. She received the gospel, but she was living in a wicked nation, just doing the things that she always did until those spies came, and on her roof, she said, hey, I will send you out another way. Gave them the information they needed, helped to save their life, and then these men could now testify, hey, there's a woman in that nation. It's a wicked heathen nation. We're going to destroy that nation, but you're going to see a red, you're going to see a crimson ribbon hanging from a certain door. Spare her. She's a believer, right? She was justified by the works that she had done. She proved the faith that was in her heart. So we see then, and we can use this as a proof text from Revelation chapter 3. Go back there. Revelation chapter 3. When people come at you with this dead, Faith is dead, being alone. In other words, it just doesn't exist. In other words, it's just not a real thing. It doesn't even make sense in the context of our own understanding. If I was to just keel over and just die right here, and my body's laying here, and the police come, and they're like, well, what is going on? Who is this guy? You would say, that's Josh Gander, right? I'm dead, but I'm still Josh Gander. Even so, faith, it exists, though it is dead, it's still a thing. And the faith is enough to save you, but it's not enough to justify you before men. Use that as a proof test. Show people that, as it says, thou hast a name that thou livest and are dead. You live, but you are dead. It says this in verse 2, be watchful and strengthen the things which remain that are ready to die, for I have not found thy works perfect before God. So the thing that we're starting to understand is that though these people have a name, though this church, though this preacher has a name that he liveth, he's actually dead, but there's no opportunity for it. It's not as if he can't do anything. Otherwise, the next verse would make no sense. He says, you are dead. You are dead. Wouldn't that just be the end of it? You're not going to talk to the dead man. He doesn't exist. There's nothing going on. No, he's dead because he has faith, but he has not the works to back it up. So then God takes the dead and gives him a charge. He says, be watchful and strengthen the things which are made, which are ready to die. There is still hope for the dead man, we see. There is still opportunity for the dead man. Do we not believe in a God that raises the dead? And this is what he does. He takes somebody that has faith and no works. Maybe they've been there for 20 years. They're not getting involved in the ministry at all. They're not helping anybody at all. People are coming to them all the time and seeking needs, seeking counsel, seeking advice, seeking love, seeking everything that a Christian should be giving because of their faith, but they don't have the works to even justify themselves before their family, before their friends. Nobody has any idea that they have faith, but here there is hope even for that dead man. If you have been not preaching the gospel that you believed 10 years ago, not preaching the gospel that you believed 20 years ago, 5 years ago, if you've been out of the loop, out of the ministry, not getting involved, if you have no works to show your faith, you're dead as a doornail spiritually, there is hope for you. God can raise you from the dead. He's going to give charges to this church as to how they can do such a thing. He says, be watchful and strengthen. Be watchful and strengthen the things which remain. There are still some things, even in a believer's life who is far from God, completely backslidden, not interested in following. If they ever followed God at some time, those things can be rekindled. There is something that remains that they can strengthen and that they can watch after. There would be no reason to give these instructions if being dead was it. If that was the finality of even the believer, that once you're dead, once you have that faith, but there's no works to follow it up, once you're dead and done, that's it. There would be no reason to have these types of conversations between God and the dead man. But here, though there are imperfect or incomplete works, and though those things are ready to die, they can be resurrected. And how is it? You need to watch and you need to strengthen. Now, regarding each and every one of us, we live in a dead country. We may have a dead marriage. We may be in a dead church. We may have a dead end job. We may have a dead relationship with our family, our parents. We may have a dead relationship with our children. There may be death all around us because there is faith, but no works involved in any of these things. There's no Christian reach. There's nothing in these relationships, these situations. It is spiritually dead. Imperfect, incomplete, wanting, and alone, Regarding those things, there is hope. God can raise them. What do? We be watchful. How many times did Jesus say, hey, watch and pray? He said, watch ye therefore and pray. He said, what I say unto you, I say unto all, watch. What, could ye not watch with me 1 hour, is what he asked his disciples there in Gethsemane. Jesus is constantly encouraging people to watch, to be attentive, to be involved, to be motivated, to be circumspect, to be watching all around, to be prepared, to be praying. And that's what watching always does. Watching and praying, seeing, praying. Just be constantly watching around, keeping an eye on things. Circumspect, watching all around you, prepared to pray. Could you not pray? Could you not watch with me 1 hour? Was the charge that Jesus said. And that's what you need to do. You need to hold fast. You need to fasten yourselves upon something like being watchful. This is how you're going to resurrect the dead country, the dead marriage, the dead church, the dead job, the dead everything in your life. The spiritually dead is raised by watching and praying, by being attentive to these things and praying. Strengthen, watch and be strengthened. Go to Psalms, if you would, Psalms chapter 27. I'll just rip through a few Psalms here about strengthen. Psalm chapter 27 and verse 14. Psalm chapter 27 and verse 14, the Bible says, wait on the Lord, be of good courage, and he shall strengthen thine heart. Wait, I say, on the Lord. And here, from the standpoint of watch and pray, we think that's a very passive activity. But watching and praying is actually the foundation from which this action of strengthening comes. You watch, you pray, you're attentive, you're trying to get involved, you're trying to get active. You're trying to raise that thing from the dead, you're just watching, you're praying. You're trying to get life back into this dead faith that you've been living in. Wait on the Lord while you're doing what? Watching and praying. Be of good courage while you're watching and praying, and he shall strengthen thine heart. Wait, I say, on the Lord. Psalm 31 and verse 24. Be of good courage, and he shall strengthen your heart. All ye that hope in the Lord. Everybody that's watching, everyone that's directed to, praying unto, appointed, waiting, hold fast upon God by faith, he shall strengthen you. He shall lift up your heart. Go to Psalm chapter 41 and verse 3. Psalm 41 and verse 3. The Lord will strengthen. Psalm 41 verse 3. The Lord will strengthen him upon the bed of languishing. Okay? You're languishing. There's no life there. There's death. You're just like a sorry lob. You're laying there in the bed. You're defeated. You're beaten. You can't rest. You can't wake. You can't revive. You can't do anything. The Lord will strengthen him upon the bed of languishing. Thou will make all his bed in his sickness. I said, Lord, be merciful unto me. Heal my soul, for I have sinned against thee. And that's usually where we find ourselves, in that state of deadness, in that state of languishing, in that state of lack of fear. It's because lack of faith. It's because we've removed ourselves from the position of faith. Having faith, having that substance of things hoped for, evidence of things not seen, we've let go of that thing. We've let these things die. We need to bring ourselves back to the point where we can believe and we can trust him and allow him to lift us up from that bed of languishing, and his mercy will be there to catch hold of us. Psalm chapter 68 and verse 28. Psalm 68, 28. Thy God hath commanded thy strength. So God's literally commanding strength to return unto these. He has commanded thy strength. Strengthen, O God, that which thou hast wrought for us. The prayer goes there. Watch under pray. And God commands the strength to return, to come into even the dead in spirit. Even those that are dead as a doornail, nothing remain. There's nothing in the works section that's going to show, justify, give the indication that that person is in fact a believer. Dead as a doornail. Psalm 119 and verse 28. The Bible says, my soul melteth for heaviness, strengthen thou me according to thy word. And it's the word of God that's going to allow for that strength to enter into somebody. It's also the word of God that allows you to have the faith to believe that God can do it. We just read a whole bunch of verses that indicate that God will give strength, that God will appoint strength. God will command strength to those that are waiting for him, to those that are watching, to those that are praying unto him, to those that are languishing, to those that have a soul that's melting for heaviness, that seems defeated. There's no hope in them. They're fine. They're dead spiritually. But God, when that strength is sought for, gives the strength. And it's the very God that strengthens us that we need to be fastening ourselves unto. Faith fastened is best fastened to the God in heaven. Psalm 138, verse 3. Psalm 138 and verse 3. Psalm 138 and verse 3. In the day when I cried, thou answerest me, and strengthenest me with strength in my soul. God gave that strength to those that were crying unto him. They cried, they received. They cried, and they received. And now we see why the Bible would say something, why God would appoint the messenger, the angel, to come to this angel, the church, and give that appointment that, hey, I see that you have a name that you liveth. You have a reputation as one that lived, but you're dead. He says, be watchful and strengthened. And what do? When we do that, we watch, we pray, and God, waiting on him, gives us the strength. With those seven spirits, with that great spiritual provision, he comes into our lives and gives us exactly what we need at exactly the right time. The Spirit of the Lord, of counsel, of wisdom, of might, of understanding, of knowledge, and the fear of God. Each of those spirits are things that we are lacking in our lives at times. And the only way that we can receive them is by watching and praying and waiting for God to strengthen us in those things. Pray for strength. Pray for God to do great things in your life and watch into these things. Hold fast unto him in these times. Go to Ecclesiastes chapter 12. Ecclesiastes chapter 12. We're going to keep going to the right after Proverbs. In Ecclesiastes, you'll find in chapter 12. Ecclesiastes chapter 12, in verse 11, it says, the words of the wise are as goads, and as nails fastened by the masters of assemblies, which are given from one shepherd. A little bit of a cryptic type of language here, a poetic verse that is indicating that there's one shepherd imparting unto the masters of assemblies, the seven spirits, we could put these here, and they're giving that wisdom out as goads and as nails that are fastened, okay? So what you see here is that the goad is something that pokes and something that prods and something that provokes. In generally speaking, it's either like a big beast of some sort, like a cow or whatever. This is what a goat is used for. And a nail is always used to hold in place. So when it says it's talking about goads and nails and they're fastened, I think basically this is just the indicator that I have seen is that it's a staff of sorts that's poking up this way and kind of coming down this way. So you can poke and you can prod with these things, and you can also hook and you can also pull with these things. And this is how they would actually lead about the livestock, was with the goad and the nails fastened. And what this is pointing to us, and this verse just kept coming to my mind, was that thing about being watched and being strengthened and holding fast unto those types of things. God says in the Psalms, thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. And that's the same opportunity, the same implement that you have. In the shepherd's staff, it's a hook and it's a rod at the other end, right? So that is the same thing. It's to poke and to provide and to provoke and to actually pull and to bring in closer. And God is saying here that the words of the wise are just like that. So even as we read that we cry and that we receive strength by the word of God, these same words of God are there to do what the Bible says they hear. From one shepherd, the wisdom comes out, and it's there as a goad, it's there as a nail, and it's there to bring us to God. And we need to trust that. We need to fasten ourselves in that same way, as that nail would stick in and would pull, and as that goad would poke and would point us in the right direction. That's what God's trying to do in our lives by his word. Go back to Revelation chapter 3. Revelation chapter 3. And in verse 3, it says, remember, 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 which means that, and that's how we know that the indication is that this was living and was dead. This was doing the works and is not doing them anymore. This was showing out the faith that it had, and now it's not happening anymore. But God calls us to remember. If you've backslidden, if you've fallen away from serving God, remember, therefore, how thou hast received and heard, how the words of the wise entered in, how the word of God entered in, how the correction and the rebuke had entered in, how the strength of God was one day working in your life, how the spirits of the Lord, the spirit of counsel, wisdom, all that was enabling you in your life at some time. Remember, you've heard these things, you've received these things, and this, and hold fast and repent. Remember the things that are dying, waiting to die. Grab a hold of them and repent. Change your mind. Do what is right now. You've fallen away. You've done wrong. Hold fast and repent. Turn to those things that you did at such a time before. Such a time before you were dead, when you were once alive. You have that reputation that you live. Turn back to where you were at one point. And how do you do that? Watch. Strengthen. Remember you've received and heard. Hold fast to the things that you have received and repent. By faith, trust God, trust His word, and get back to where you are. Or, and here's the danger that enters in if you don't, Christian, there's a warning here, and it's going to continue. It says, if therefore thou shalt not watch. So if you're not watching, if you're not waiting for the strength of God to return unto you, if you don't want to be revived at this time, I will come on thee as a thief, and thou shalt not know what hour I shall come upon thee. And this is quite often the thing that is used. We know when the pre-tribulation rapture is being expounded, they'll say, oh, it's a thief in the night. Oh, it's a thief in the night is how the Lord's going to come. Here, that's a direct threat that God is using. We already heard about that in the last lesson that we had. God is threatening those that refuse to hold fast and repent, that refuse to try to get that dead name living again, to try to get that dead thing strengthened and built up again, to be revived by God. God is correcting them. God is chasing them. God is threatening them that if they will not repent, He will come as a thief. And it's like having a portion with the unbelievers. Go to Thessalonians. Keep your finger there. Go to 1 Thessalonians. In 1 Thessalonians, we have the famous rapture verse. And everyone will say, oh, the Lord's coming as a thief in the night. And this is how we know that it's pre-tribulation and it's a secret rapture and nobody knows about it. But the reality is that can be further from the truth. The come as a thief is a portion for the unbelievers. And it's a threat used in Revelation to believers that you'll be just like them. You'll have a portion with the unbelievers if you refuse to repent of this dead as a doornail faith that you have. In 1 Thessalonians 4, and in verse 15, it starts by saying, for this we say unto you by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not prevent them which are asleep. Okay, so this is the coming of the Lord, and it's the word of the Lord that's exhorting us here at this time. This is His return. This is the second coming of Jesus Christ. Verse 16, for the Lord Himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of an archangel, with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then, here's the rapture now, we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. Wherefore, comfort one another with these words. This is specifically talking to Christians who had lost loved ones in the tribulation that they were experiencing at the time in the Thessalonian church. They had lost to persecution. They had lost to famine. They had lost to diseases. And they were starting to think to themselves, are we in the end times? What in the world is going on? Things are so dark. Things are so dim. And the apostle writes to encourage them. Comfort one another. They're going to rise first, and we will join them at such a time as we're discussing, at the day that the Lord Himself shall descend, at the coming of the Lord. But then He says this to them. He's trying to reassure them and bring them back down so they can understand that, hey, there's a little bit of time that's going to come first. He says in verse 1 of chapter 5, but of the times and the seasons, brethren, ye have no need that I write unto you. Okay? For yourselves know perfectly that the day of the Lord so cometh as a thief in the night. Quite often when this is preached, they'll stop there. And they say, we have no need that I write unto you. I don't need to explain this unto you because there's no signs of the coming of the Lord. And because we don't need to know these signs because it's just going to happen like a thief in the night. We're just going to zoom away. There's nothing that's going to happen before that. But we need to read on into the context, as I always encourage, whenever a false doctrine comes before me. It says in verse 3, for when they, okay, grab a hold of that. When they shall say, so remember, he's writing to believers, and he says, when they shall say, peace and safety, then sudden destruction cometh upon them, as travail upon a woman with child, and they shall not escape. So they, being not we, being not us, being not believers, being not the direct appointment of where the who he is writing to, he says, when they shall say peace and safety, sudden destruction will come upon them as travail upon a woman with child, and they shall not escape. But he's going to bring it back, okay? This is why we need to continue reading on in the scripture. It says, but ye, who? Brethren. But ye, brethren. So they have destruction. They're going to cry peace and safety. They shall not escape. But ye, brethren, are not in darkness, that day should overtake you as a thief. This indicates that day is not going to be a surprise. That day is not going to be as a thief coming in, just swooping away, taking away the believers, taking away ye, brethren. It's not going to happen that way unless you're dead. Unless you're spiritually dead and not watching, then hey, brace yourselves, because that day shall come upon you as a thief, because that's exactly what God promised in Revelation in chapter 3 and verse 3. He says, if therefore thou shalt not watch, I will come on thee as a thief, and thou shalt not know what hour I come upon thee. These that are saying that there's going to be no indication of God's return, they're saying it's going to happen just like a thief. They're essentially embracing the very threat that God put upon them for being ignorant and unbelievers, for not watching and strengthening the things that remain. Those that are on Easy Street, those that are cruising, that are on to retirement, those lazy preachers that just want to swipe on out of here, that use something like a pre-tribulation rapture to encourage their flock to just keep sending the money. Hey, Jesus could come right now. Bring in the tithe, bring in the offering, bring in the emotional driven weeping down here at the altar. Those things that they use, they take that doctrine to try to encourage people away from the truth. And the truth is that if you are watching, if you are strengthening the things that remain, and you know there's a lot lacking around here. Here in Canada, we live in a spiritually dead country. We've all been to spiritually dead churches. We all have spiritually dead family members. We all have relationships in our lives that we have let die. But watch! Strengthen, allow God to take hold of these, revive these things, and if you're doing those things, God's not coming as a thief. God knows that you're paying attention. God knows that you're reading your Bible. God knows that you're hearing the preaching. And God's going to allow for all of these things that remain that perhaps are ready to die. He's going to allow for those things to strengthen you, and he won't come as a thief. God will let you know exactly. Behold, I will do nothing, saith the Lord, but he revealeth his secrets unto his servants, the prophets. If you're listening to the preaching of my voice today, if you're listening to the preaching of other people's voices today, if you're listening to the preaching that comes from the very scriptures that are before you, day in and day out, God will not sneak up on you. He will not come as a thief. He's going to reveal these things unto you, and you will not be in doubt. You will not be worried. You will not be taken away into the destruction that awaits the unbelievers. But if you're dead, if you're not watching, brace yourself, because God will come upon you as a thief. If you're dead and not watching, if you're not strengthening the things that are dying, if you're not laying hold upon the things that remain in your life, where you've fallen away from things that you once did, where you've fallen away from reading your Bible like you once did, you've fallen away from preaching the gospel like you once did, you've fallen away from prayer, you've fallen away from studying, loving your neighbor, you've fallen away from all these things. If you're not willing to strengthen those things and hold fast unto them and be faithful unto God at such a time as this, and you're dead state, God will sneak up on you as a thief in the night, and you'll have a portion with the unbelievers. Yeah, you're going to heaven, but it's going to be a great and crying shame to find God not letting you in, not letting you know, not giving you opportunity to see these things coming, and as the Bible says, do great exploits. I want to be numbered with those that in the last days, it's like, thus saith the Lord. This is exactly what the Bible promised, preaching the gospel, preaching the truth, proclaiming the truth while everyone is falling dead around me from the plagues that God is pouring out during the tribulation. from the plagues that the Antichrist is pouring out during the tribulation, the persecution, the suffering that is coming right before God shows up to set things right. I want to be the one there proclaiming these truths because I'm aware, because I'm watching, because I'm praying, and God's strengthening those things that remain, even in a dead as a doornail country. God knows that even in your dead, lacking, alone state, and He gives that charge to you. If you're dead today, hold fast. If you're dead today, be fastened by faith unto God as nails, as goads. Just allow God to move in your life and to take hold of you and to lead you where He needs to, so that even when you can't hold on, and this is what's going to happen, we're going to get to times that are so hard when it feels like we can't even move on, we can't even go further. Those are the times when great exploits are coming your way. Because the Bible says, if we believe not, yet He abideth faithful, He cannot deny Himself. So even in the times when we don't even have it in us to fasten our faith unto the God that is leading us, He will take control. He will take over. And the Bible says in Ephesians chapter 6, you have the whole armor on you. It says, having done all, stand. Having done all, I've done everything I possibly can. Just stand. Just stand and see the salvation of God. I want to be numbered with those ranks, not with those that are deceived, that are blinded, that are not strengthening the things that remain, that are just giving up, that are putting blinders on, that are just hiding themselves from the truth. Those are the ones, just as they said, hey, the Lord cometh as a thief in the night. Yeah, to you, if that's what you want, keep putting your head in the sand. Keep denying the scriptures that are being proclaimed. Keep denying the fact that some of these documentaries revealing the error of the pre-tribulation rapture have been seen by millions upon millions upon millions. Even these guys that deny the post-trib pre-wrath rapture have watched after the tribulation, and they're still in denial. Well, the Lord's coming as a thief. The Lord's cometh as a thief. Yeah, amen to you, says the Bible in Revelation chapter 3. If that's what you want, verse 4 says, thou hast a few names, okay? A few names even in Sardis. So here the context given is, even in Sardis, in Revelation chapter 3 and verse 4, there are a few names. Even in Canada, there are a few names. Even for those of us who are out there and we're in the prairies, or we're in the boonies, or we're somewhere where there's just not a lot of options for good churches. Even if you're in a dead as a doornail church, okay, there are a few names. And it says of these few names, even in Sardis. I like how it says that, as if like, wow, even in Sardis, there are a few names. Even in Canada, there's a remnant. Even in, oh, that situation, this household, this family, oh, there are a few names which have not defiled their garments, and they shall walk with me in white, for they are worthy. These names are undefiled. They are cleaned by Jesus Christ. They're not dead, right? They have faith with works, because that's something that is dead. It's something that's defiled. The Bible says that when something drops dead, whether it's a beast or a man, the Levitical priests were not to go near it because they would be defiled for the opportunity of ministry that they had. They could not go near these things. So this group is not defiled, meaning they have faith and they have works. Believers, we need to be of those that are named, even in Canada, even in Toronto, which are not defiled, clean by Jesus Christ spiritually, amen, but living out the works that are fit for a believer in Jesus Christ, working out our own salvation, my personal salvation that God gave me, working it out with fear and trembling. Those are those that are undefiled. Those are those that are named. Those are those that are numbered in even a putrid situation like we have here in Toronto, Canada. There is a few names. There are a few named that have not defiled their garments. Okay? And the Bible says that they are working out their own salvation. They have faith with works. They are not dead like everybody else around them, and they are worthy. Why are they worthy? Why are we worthy? It's not because of our own worthiness. It's not because I'm so great that God would welcome me and worthy to not suffer such things. In fact, the Bible says, pray that thou be worthy to escape these things. This should be something on our regular everyday prayer requests, is that we're just like, God, great and trouble and tribulation times are coming. I pray that I will escape such things. I pray that I will be worthy to escape such things. Why are we worthy? Well, because our filthy rags, because our righteousness has been all put on Jesus. My righteousness is no good. It's filthy. It's stinking. It's tainted. It is defiled. And God took my righteousness. He took my filthy rags. He took my garments. And when Jesus Christ hung upon that cross, He laid them over His shoulders. Can you imagine, spiritually speaking, if you could get an eye, if you could see into the spiritual realm, as Elijah's servant did when he looked into the heavens and saw that there were many more numbered with him than were numbered with the armies of the earth. Could you imagine the spiritual vision to see the sins of all mankind, the filthy rags, even the righteousnesses that people tried to put before God? You know, I'm a good Catholic. I'm a pretty good person. I pray every day. I prayed the Joel Osteen prayer every day. I give to charity. Lord, look at me. I in thy name cast out devils. In thy name do many wonderful works. All those filthy, disgusting garments were held upon the shoulders of our Lord and Savior as he breathed his last breath. Just filth and disgusting placed upon him. I'm not worthy. That's the picture of me. That's garbage being thrown at my Savior. That's garbage and filth and disgustingness just being laid upon Him. All of the sins that I have committed, all the sins that I will commit in my life and all of yours as well, just put upon our Savior. We're not worthy because of our own worthinesses, for our worthinesses is filthy rags. But that, glory to God, fell upon Him, and we took in its place His righteousness. You imagine that, the spiritual vision to see Amen. God taking filth and giving us crystal clear living waters. Glory to God. Now Amen. God looks at me, and simply because I say, yes, Lord, I believe that. That was for me. That's the free gift of eternal life. I had nothing to add towards that. It's more disgusting, filthy, just grossness. That's what I have here. Have more of this. What am I going to throw before God in exchange for the free gift that He gave me of living waters, bread of life, cleansing flow of His blood coming upon me so that God looks at me and says, welcome to my kingdom, son, as if it was Jesus Himself standing before me. The Bible says that my righteousness are as filthy rags, but His righteousness came upon me in exchange for mine, and now I am worthy. What the worthy does then is just like we talked about. By grace you are saved through faith, but we are ordained unto good works that we should walk in them. And the group here, the few names that are named in Canada, the few names that are named in Toronto, the few names that are named all over the world are walking worthy, doing what things are meet for the salvation that they have received. They have faith. Amen. They're going to heaven, but they have the works to back it up. And there are a lot of people that are just saved without the works, and they are dead. And what's going to happen to the dead man? They'll get snuck up on as a thief. But if you are alive unto God, if you have rendered yourself to be dead unto sin and are seeking the things which are above, where Christ sitteth at the right hand of God the Father, then there is the position of those few names that have not defiled their garments and are worthy at such a time as this. The Bible says in verse 5, he that overcometh, he that overcometh. Again, I'm not going to be preaching or tagging on that, hey, we just got to do all these works and then God's going to somehow give us some sort of esteemed position. We already determined that we're filthy, disgusting rags. But all that can be asked of the filthy, disgusting vessel that I still live in, my resurrected, born again spirit still lives in, the one that I'm feeding, the one that I will not let die if I continue to seek Him, if I continue to hold fast, be watchful, strengthen those things which are remain. That alive and quickened spirit's going to drop this flesh dead as a doornail. The one thing that it can do at this point is simply yield to the desires of the inner man, yield to the desires of the resurrected man. All that can be asked of us is that in our dead flesh, in our dead situation, in our dead families, in our dead lives, in our dead city, we hold fast with faith to the resurrected Savior. And how do you overcome in this situation? The same way you always overcome, by faith in Christ. God's not going to take the Christian that, yes, has faith and has believed and now has works, but is doing those works entirely within the power of their own flesh. He's not going to accept those as somebody that's undefiled and worthy of such a time as this. Perhaps God will sneak up on even the self-righteous Christian, full of pride, full of arrogancy, thinking he's better than everybody. Perhaps he will even sneak up on that as a thief in the night. Why? Because those sacrifices are not acceptable. Our flesh, even doing right, is not acceptable in the eyes of God. The only thing that pleases the Lord is faith. And so by overcoming, or through faith we will overcome in reality, what we receive is the promises made unto this churches. You will not be overtaken as a thief. You will be strengthened because you're watching unto prayer. You will be alive, alive, alive forevermore, even as Jesus is alive. And he that overcometh, the same will be clothed in white raiment. And I will not blot out his name out of the book of life, but I will confess his name before my Father and before his angels. That first promise being made to those that have believed upon him, sealed in the book of life. The second being confessed before the Father, before his angels. I believe that's a special opportunity to those that are of the few, those that are named, those that have been strengthened, those that have been watching unto prayer, those that know what is coming, those that have believed the entirety of the scriptures, those that are seeking his face and constantly trying to do what is right in the sight of God, those will be confessed before the Father. Those will be confessed and named. See, Jesus Christ has a list. Hey, Lord, these are getting into heaven. Great, he can refer to the list. But there's special ones, I believe, that are going to be actually confessed to the Father, proclaimed to the Father, given opportunity to be a little bit higher, right? The least in the kingdom of heaven and the greatest in the kingdom of heaven indicates that there are tiers. There's going to be some that are ruling over this province, among this 50s, among this, and all of these rewards, including the many crowns that are available, go to those that have the opportunity and have taken hold of the opportunity, even as we discussed earlier, to do what God says, to have a living faith and not just die in the faith that you have. He that hath an ear, you got one today? Let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches and to each one of us individually. We need to be bound to God. Our glue, our nail, the thing that fastens us to our master, to our chief shepherd, is the faith that we put in him. Keep that faith settled in him. Keep that faith fastened to him. And this is the charge that was given to the church in Sardis. It seems like they might have at large rejected it, but there's a few. There's a city here. It seems like many people have heard the message, but they've rejected it. But there's a few. And those few will stand clean garments, worthy, walking with the Savior, doing great exploits, doing wonders, doing miracles, doing something. Who knows what God hath prepared for them? They'll be confessed before his Father, before the angels. Thank you, God, for this.